those
were
things.
You one of the guys that were on, or just
no? They didn't. I was in the back of the room. They didn't know I was there.
Okay.
And then, in retrospect, as you look at it, we won the last 11 games.
Mm-hmm. And some great names. Johnny Unitas is probably the most obvious.
Yeah. Earl Morrill, John Unitas, John Mackey, mm-hmm. Bubba Smith. Mm-hmm. We had great defense.
And what happened then as a result of your time there? What was the outcome of being in Baltimore there?
Well, we obviously won Super Bowl V, mm-hmm. and then we were 5 points away from going back to Super Bowl again the next year. Miami beat us. That was their first undefeated season.
Wow.
Their undefeated season.
And I think, so you went from literally being cut by the Detroit Lions to being picked up by the Colts, winning a Super Bowl, got a touchdown, right? As a fullback, got a touchdown in that Super Bowl.
I scored the tying touchdown with 3 minutes to go, and O'Brien took the field goal with 8 seconds. I classify it as going from the outhouse to the penthouse.
Good way to put it. Yeah, very good way to put it. I think you're in good company with one of the recent Lions. I think there was a guy last year, a fullback, by the name of Sean McHugh, who was let go by the Lions and then picked up by the Pittsburgh Steelers, who obviously won the Super Bowl last year. So I don't know. We got to look at the Detroit Lions and their decision-making with the fullbacks, I guess. But seriously, though, so you had a great run there with the Colts, Super Bowl next year, right, almost there again. When did you realize that maybe football was going to be one of the things that you have to let go at some point?
When Carol Rosenblum traded the Colts to L.A. and Bob Ersey became the owner, he hired a guy named Joe Thomas, and Joe Thomas started cleaning house or wanting to clean house.
Mm. Bringing in younger guys, or what was he doing?
Unitas, Maddie, and myself mm-hmm. were the first three to hit the road. Mm. And then, you know, as a 30-year-old running back, played 8 years in the league, you're not the top of many people's list.
Isn't that funny? At 30 years old at that time, they consider you out the pasture, so to speak.
Well, they can get a couple of young kids that got a lot of potential.
Fresh legs.
Pay them less money.
Yeah. Nowadays, the age would be a lot different at this point. I mean, the 30-year-old fullback would be guy halfway through his career, so to speak. But so as time went on, you realized that, you know, you were going to be released again by the Colts. And as far as from that point on, something else, you had to look at other options if you're going to still play. But at that point, we have to stop at this moment because we're going to take a little break. When I come back, we're going to finish up and talk about why Tom got out of pro sports, out of NFL football, and also have studio audience questions when we come back from Glory Days.
I am stuffed.
After that meal, I have got to pass gas.
Powder room's right there.
No! Daddy's gas can kill us all!
That's right. Toxic clouds like the one I'm about to unleash could make everyone deathly ill. Even that baby of yours. Be right back.
Secondhand smoke contains hydrogen cyanide and other deadly gases.
What a guy.
Oh, he is a keeper.
Don't pass gas. Take it outside.
Can I ask a few questions about the apartment on Park Street?
What was your name?
My name is Juan Hernandez.
It's been rented.
Hello, my name is Sanjay Kumar. I am calling about the apartment on Park Street.
It just rented.
My name is Tyrone Washington. I'm calling about the apartment for rent on Park Street.
It's not available.
I use a wheelchair. And
it's gone.
Hello, my name is Graham Wellington. I'm calling about the apartment for rent on Park Street. Is that still available?
Yes, it is.
Oh, it is?
Housing discrimination is illegal. If you think you've been a victim, call us.
Kurt David with our guest Tom Nowotzki, former Detroit Lion. Tom, we ended off that last segment talking about those years from Detroit then to Baltimore. As you mentioned, they started going to younger players, to cut some of the good veterans at that point. Thought it was possibly over for you, but then had a little light at the end of the tunnel, possibly playing some more. What were some of the options you had at that point?
Well, Bill Curry and I were traded to Houston, and Houston was a sort of a startup team, and I thought I had a chance to play there, so I went to training camp. But after the third practice, Sid Gilman called me in and told me that I had to prove to him I could still play football. Mm. And I told him I don't. I said, I'm going home.
So at that point, you made a decision to say, okay, I'm done with it at this point. I mean, got home, and then what happened?
And Abe Griffin called from Chicago, wanted me to go to Chicago and back up Dick at linebacker. Mm-hmm. And I said, Abe, I'll go, but don't put me through training camp and then cut me. Mm. And guess what? George Collins cut me the last cut, and Abe said he was sorry. And
yeah, you felt the business side of the NFL.
Abe was a great guy, though. And this summer, he and I were the first two inducted in our high school Hall of Fame, and I gave a scholarship for the pro scholarship for next year for the kids from my high school.
So obviously no hard feelings.
No. Abe's been dead for about 10 years.
And as far as after that cut then from Chicago, at that point did you realize that pro football was done? What helped you make that decision or know that
it was
done?
Well, it helped me a lot because I had a job. I mean, I was a salesman for Brown Trailer. I sold semi equipment and I had something to go to, and it was an easy transition, although anybody that tells you it's easy, it's not easy. I mean, you miss the guys, especially the guys in Baltimore.
What made it difficult for you? Well, missing the teammates?
When you win, okay, I didn't realize how much I missed those guys or what a family we had until 12 years later. I'd gone through the divorce, and my second wife said, you know, why don't you ever go back to Baltimore? So I went back, and it was like I'd gone home. You know, it was great.
So you missed that aspect of it as
well. You missed the people, yeah.
What about the competition, things like that? What else makes it difficult for you?
Competition is competition. If you were in the game, you'd enjoy that. I mean, pro athletes enjoy that competition.
In fact, you're able to apply some of that competitive spirit to what you're doing now. As far as you do sales and things of this sort now.
Yes.
And how do you apply that, what you learned in the NFL as a pro football player, into what you do today?
Well, you know, basic principles of business, okay? You learn that as a football player. Okay, do what's right, work hard, give 100%, detail, okay? Detail's important. If you're gonna sell something, the details, the small things are important. You know, the guy wants a blue trailer, don't try to sell him a red one, okay?
Which we should back up. What is it that you're doing now with your time?
I have like a car dealership, but only in semi trucks, trailers. I can get 12 big trailers in at one time in North Territory Road in Ann Arbor or Whitmore Lake. And that's what I do. I sell parts, service, and
it's your own
repair.
Service center now, Service Center there. So
yes.
And that started from the early years when you worked for Dane, was it? Or who was it you were working for?
I worked for Brown Trailer.
Brown Trailer for a while. So back in your era, the guys played football or professional sports, but they also had a job during the offseason. It was almost expected at that point, right?
And that's correct.
You had that foundation as a result of that. And you know, it's kind of off-the-job training, or on-the-job training, actually, that you were doing that whole time.
When we started, football was a seasonal job. Okay, you didn't play year-round, exercise and train year-round like they do now. Okay, they only have like 6 weeks off now, maybe not even that. They got these OTAs and so on and so forth. So you could do that. We'd work on Mondays, half a days, and we worked 2 and 3 half days a week at our off-season job.
So you work really? So even during the season, you'd work during
yes.
like that. Well, salaries were different then too, and you were a number 6 draft pick overall. Is that correct? You were
5.
Number 5 draft pick, and as a result. You know, you had a signing bonus and a salary, but that's a little bit different than a number 5 overall right now, wouldn't you say?
I got $45,000 bonus with a new Pontiac, because Pontiac represented.
So your signing bonus was $45,000,
and I had a 3-year no cut, $45,000 a year.
Any idea what it's like now as far as for a number 5?
Over 40, probably.
Yeah, over 45,000.
Million, 40
oh, yeah,
million.
Okay, over 45,000. We know that as
if
a
Jake Long can get $62 million, I was worth 40. Okay.
Well, you're very active now too. You're still involved with the NFL, and what can you tell us about your capacity, what you do with the NFL now, and how you're involved?
I've been president alumni here in Detroit for about 9 years, and I've been on the board for about 6 years nationally. There's 9 members, and right now we're in the process of changing the board, and the NFL alumni is going to become an advocate for the retired players.
That's
happening right now.
Okay, what can we expect out of that as a result?
Well, Roger Goodell is allowing us to use the shield to make money to take care of the retired players. Instead of giving so much money to charity, because they give enough to charity, he wants us to engage all the players to join so that the retired players are under one roof.
And that makes sense. I know it's something that's been pushed for many, many years as a result, to take care of the guys that played back in the eras of past.
Yes.
And now it's starting to come to fruition.
The problem you have is the NFLPA, which is the union, represents the current players. And they don't represent the retired players. And getting the retired players to understand that and join up is important.
To join up?
To join the alumni. Because there's 5,000 people that don't belong to anybody.
They're just
out there.
And that's part of your role as well, is to help.
I'm part
kind
of a group trying to get that done.
Sure. So between that and busy with the service center, obviously it's taken up a lot of your time. And what, you know, in your opinion, what is it that helps you right now? Thinking about those pinnacle years of your sports and everything, what helps you now to understand that this is just something in my past, it's an old phase of my life, and I'm able to apply these new things in my life right now?
Well, there's a good saying that we had in Baltimore, it is what it is, okay? So don't try and tell me what it isn't, okay? I'm just living what I have. Mm-hmm. I'm dealing with what I have in front of me.